I'd like to talk about the multidisciplinary research using human pluripotent stem cells, which we have been doing for maybe 10 years or more. So our institute is, as introduced briefly, its name is Institute for Integrated Cell Material Sciences. So we have tried a very ambitious target of using chemistry, physics, and cell biology. Maybe 7 years ago, we have several success and challenges, of course. And so you probably know the name of embryo stem cells and iPS cells. Those cells are pluripotent stem cell lines, and it has a great ability to produce a homogeneous population of quality-controlled, many functional human cells, but not cancer cells, relatively normal functional cells in enormous amount. And of course, but we need many kind of technology like derivation and growth and differentiation and some engineering. Okay, so recently, towards the later phase of my scientific career, I'm more interested in the to contribute to the real application or practical application of these cell lines. So the key issue, I'm not a clinical doctor, so key issue is how to make large-scale production system of high-quality stem cells and differentiated cells. And every technology should be very robust and reliable for the real application, in particularly in clinical purpose. And cost is also a key issue for practical application. So for this activity, Japan has not many very active bio venture or startup company like in USA, which can bridge the from the basic research to the application. However, one system we have in Japan is government is provides a relatively large fund to make and operate multi-sector consortium. And I have been leading probably 10 years of academia collaboration team of academia and industry. So today I talk about two results, and also those are results of the collaboration between our groups and companies. Okay, so first topic is how to make large quantity of stem cells. And we go for the three-dimensional culture system with functional polymers applied to this approach. So okay, why we need large quantity of cells? Okay, so for laboratory scale, usually we use dishes or flask. For example, this relatively large dish of 10 centimeter diameter can make 2 or 3 times 10 to 6, not exceeding 10 to 7 cells only, actually. And but for mouse, for disease model mouse, you can work on making neurons, for example, from this 10 to 7 or less, and transplant some cells, that's kind of cells, into one dish, one mouse. But it's okay, but human has probably 3,000 times more body weight than a mouse. And you know the cells are almost similar size. So we need at least 1,000 times more cells for practical application. And using 1,000 dish is not possible for quality control and other things. So first thing is we collaborate with a company. We specialize in dialyzing membrane and other technology to make the culture bag system, but it's still just the introduction. I skip this part because it's not so multidisciplinary. So for this kind of culture of adhesion, conventional culture needs surface to adhere for attachment of cells. So surface area actually limits the number, and you need a very good adhesion molecule for cultivate in good condition. So why go to three-dimensional without any adhesion? So this system is just a ball of the cells, and section is filled with the cells. So this is not carrier beads, just the aggregate of the cells with homogeneous size. So this system is very, we published recently, has many advantages because we don't need any adhesion molecule or surface. So we can scale up, could be. And so actually, prepotent stem cells, like embryonic stem cells, can grow in this sphere. And with some morphological examination shows the surface contain junction complex. So this is like primitive epithelium, just rounding up or opposite of rounding up. And in embryo, actually, they are making such a shape. Embryo has no, fetus has no plastic surface or glass surface, of course. And we made some improvement of the method, like replacing the spontaneous fusion between them with adding some polymer. It's a methyl cellulose. It's a not. It's a common polymers, and they grow to the larger sphere, and they start differentiation or necrosis when the diameter exceeds maybe 300 micron. So we actually push this large sphere through the filter to for mechanical disruption to smaller spheres. So it's like go to the 80 micron sphere, grow to the 250 micron sphere in 5 days, and we just disrupt to the smaller one. That's just repeating actually every 5 days or 4 days, depending on the cell line. So we is then we got the similar growth rate as conventional adhesion culture on feeder cells or matrix cells. Okay, so the enormous ability of the G's cell line, prepotent stem cell line, is you can get 10 times more cells in 1 week, and so 10,000 times more cells in 4 weeks, and they continue to grow even 1 year. So unlimited source of many human cells. These cells maintain the pluripotency and the normal karyotype and differentiation capacity in teratoma, so it's a standard evidence of pluripotency maintenance. However, this is not enough yet, because spheres, yeah, maybe three-dimensional, but they sit on the bottom of the culture vessel. So it's not really three-dimensional. So how to get to three-dimensional culture system is a conventional way is just to starting agitation. This is a bioreactor system. But somehow human pluripotent stem cells are very fragile cells, and they are easily damaged by such a physical force. Someone may claim they can do, but with a stressful condition, we observe frequently the karyotype abnormality, because maybe selecting for more robust, stronger cells, and that may be similar to the cancer cells. Okay, so the, we must be very careful to keep best comfortable condition for cells. So how to avoid shear force? And most people think of the designing the proper and some shape to minimize the shear force. But we were collaborating with a chemical company, and they came up with one polymer, polysaccharide polymer, called geran gum, produced by a kind of bacteria. And it has a very mysterious, surprising function for biologists like me. For the chemist or physicist, maybe easier to understand. So this geran gum polysaccharide polymers added at a very dilute concentration, like this one, can stop sedimentation. Okay. So the, these are 250 micron cell sphere, right? So they should go down to the bottom and stop growing naturally. But with 0.02%, for example, they keep suspended for forever, okay, 1 or 2 days. Maybe I go to next one. But you think that may be very high viscosity or hydrogel formation, but it's not. So this is a simple real-time video. I'm not sure if it works. But so just it's behave like just a liquid, but no sedimentation occurs. So this is actually plastic beads. So it's not a cell-specific function, just physical phenomenon. So it's a polysaccharide. I'm not a chemist. They make double helix, and double helix bind each other by cationic ions. And this is a methyl cellulose, more standard behavior of the polymers. So with increasing the concentration, the viscosity go up, and the sedimentation rate, how many millimeter per second or something like that, is go down slow. So it's slow, but still sinking down, going down, and with the viscosity. But this geran gum behave completely differently. So with this very minor concentration, viscosity is very slightly, only slightly going up, almost no viscosity increase. However, sedimentation rate go to zero. So they keep sedimented without viscosity or hydrogel formation. So that's showing this simple movie, just like the liquid, but they don't. So that's way, for example, we can culture these spheres with 200 milliliter capacity bag made of gas permeable membrane made by company. So this can grow 2 × 10^8 cells, it's like 20 or 30 dishes. So we put this bug on, put simply on the shelf of the CO2 incubator. No movement, no agitation. Just put in the CO2 incubator can grow these cells. Okay. So that's one topic I like to show you today is this kind of new system, culture system enabled by the polymer. And another is cardiomyocyte differentiation by cytokine free and xenofree chemical induction. Okay, so there are numerous works and papers to induce differentiation of pluripotent stem cells into cardiomyocyte or neuron or hepatocyte and other. However, usually they use cytokines and growth factor because that's actually molecule working in our body and in fetus. However, it make very high cost and quality control is very difficult for those macromolecule proteins. So we try to make solve those problems by just 10 years ago, we started to screen the chemical compound library, not very large, only 10,000 like library by making actually monkey S lines integrated with transgene of reporter gene to report the cardiomyocyte differentiation. And we found two or three hit compounds, and Professor Westgate's laboratory, chemistry laboratory, synthesized many derivatives. And we found, for example, one compound, it can induce cardiomyocyte differentiation. These compounds are still improved, continuously improved. So one thing is it's very robust differentiation. So we can get 90% of cardiomyocyte after 3 weeks in our human ESL line and monkey ESL line we derived, and standard mouse or Kyoto iPSL line, Wisconsin iPSL line, and one iPSL line derived by the startup company we founded. So it works very well. And there have been several chemical compounds which claim to induce cardiomyocyte differentiation, but the efficiency is very high. And probably today I have no time to go into detail. We only know at least one major effect of our compound is a very downstream inhibitor of Wnt signaling pathway. But probably they have additional effect also. Okay. Anyway, robustness is a key issue for the practical application. And so after 3 weeks of the induction of the differentiation, the cells population becomes like cardio spheres, so ball of cardiomyocytes beating on their own intervals, and 95% are cardiomyocytes. And they show every characteristics of the not completely matured, but relatively matured cardiomyocyte, better than the previously published papers, and majority is ventricular cardiomyocyte. It's very nice because it's important for the cell therapy probably, and also drug safety assay. And small number of pacemakers also included, and they develop very developed cytoplasmic structures. And so this is a summary. So these two people assistant professor and associate professor is actually treat the pluripotent stem cells by three chemical compounds. It was not our own invention, already previously known. Three chemical compounds induce the pluripotent stem cells to the embryonic mesoderm lineage. And they switched quickly to the next your induction media of containing our compound, and they go to the cardiomyocyte almost completely. Please notice that this step actually contains the chemical compound which activates Wnt signal pathway, and next step is actually inhibiting the pathway. So very important to switch quickly. Okay. Indeed, this, our cardiomyocyte can be used for the assay of the cardiotoxicity for new compound. This is a one compound developed for certain drugs, but found to induce cardiotoxicity and dropped out. So this our cells enough matured to indicate this kind of abnormality. And for this audience, this may be interesting. So one of our grad student, he's actually a cardiologist, clinical doctor, put the, our cardiomyocyte into the small dish of 10 millimeter and put in the calcium ion reporting dye and stimulated electrically to one end, and they just go to the hallway like our heart. But in heart, so you might we might develop some blood clogging and kill the cardiomyocyte. He made some defective area without many cardiomyocytes. And this kind of spiral wave appears, and this is a very dangerous situation. And currently used drug can actually improve that. So this kind of model is a very nice application of the those cells. So now our new government project is recruited a big company of Japan, and we really very ambitious going from the stock cell line stocks to develop the certain 10 to 8 cells, and with a bioreactor of 10 liter or 100 liter, we develop 10 to 10th or 11th pluripotent stem cells and change to the differentiation media and produce cardiomyocyte or neural stem cells in such a quantity. And we are aiming at this bioreactor without any stirring. So how to do that is still a secret, but we believe we have a good chance of succeeding in that one. So that's is my talk, very practical, but multidisciplinary collaboration, multi-sector collaboration is a key issue, key, very important factor, and collaborators in our laboratory and other laboratory. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Okay, thank you very much. Time is for questions.
Hello. Do you have any idea how the gelangum works?
Yes, I asked. Not a biologist. Yeah. So someone said it makes actually the gel, but very fragile and break easily, but reform easily. So there are small particles. Cannot break the gel, so they should, but with just rinsing, just break the gel. but I don't know if it's real or not. But your audience knows better than me, probably.
Yes, I would agree. Probably it's some physical gel with a good tuning of the kinetics and the strands of the interaction. But I have a question regarding then the exchange that are needed for the culture, because if you use a gel like this, I understand that you can prevent sedimentation by preventing motion, but at the same time,
that's a very good question.
Scaling up is that you need agitation in order to restore a reasonable diffusion. So then you are back to a viscous drag and viscous shear.
For the laboratory scale, actually adding to the basal media and reduce the concentration into half can centrifuge to the dough. But for the large scale, it's not good. So something we are thinking, filtering or some kind of new type of medium change.
Microfluidics.
Yeah, maybe.
Okay, thank you.
Some other questions? If no, let us thank again our speaker.
Thank you.